So what are we going to do today? There are collections which myself and our research student Rosie D'Souza we made just 15 meters away from this building. You know, there is a plot below Bombex Seba where we had earlier collected Termitomyces hymi. Now this hymi is a species which was earlier mistaken as albuminosus or some similar, you know, the common Termitomyces species, which was diagnosed by a mycologist from South India, well known agaricologist and mushroom scientist, a well known student of Professor C.V. Subramaniam, who is going to celebrate shortly 90 years, and former head of department, one of the best mycologists in India and Asia, Dr. D.J. Bhatt. He was also C.V. Subramaniam's student. There was also Dr. Raghu Kumar from NIO. They were all Dr. C.V. Subramaniam's students. So there is a C.V. Subramaniam School of Mycology, which has done tremendous work in micro and macro fungi. Whereas Professor Bhatt, Professor Dr. Raghu Kumar and all, they went into direction of microfungal research. Dr. Natarajan, who expired a few years ago, who was like a big guru for me, he came across this mushroom in South India and he diagnosed and named it after this Roger Haim. Understood? This is a Roger Haim's book, only phonograph in the world, which has not been translated so far. Okay, so I intend to translate it later, because I am going to come out with a detailed brochure and monograph very soon this year itself. So this book was gifted to me by my friend Dr. Santosh Raikar in the United States. When he came to know that, I badly need this book, because earlier I had photocopied this book at Agarkar Research Institute, Pune, where I had gone in 1987 for training with Dr. A.V. Sathe, who was one of the well-known mycologist from Western India, and he taught me a lot of mushroom taxonomy. So this book with keys, you can see here, and detailed studies of organs to be diagnosed is given in detail, and also it also has these type of colored plates, drawings. So these drawings also aid us in understanding the genus Termitomyces and its features. So the mycotities which I was talking about are like these fungal nodules inside the fungus cones, and you can see the active, and there are YouTube video clips which we had ourselves taken in the lab, you know. And your job today is to diagnose all these mature and immature stages of genus Termitomyces. If you study one Termitomyces species, it is like studying all 85 species. And the beauty is that world largest Termitomyces species, you see now, these are Shimperi and Robustus and those type. You see, this is Mammiformis, it has nipple like structure on the top, so it's known as Mammiformis. The other day, you know that we collected 300-400 immature stages, and I had also recorded one short description of the role of perforatorium. So this perforatorium organ is very essential, and that is the this one which in this painting has been depicted, this protruding organ, and this area is known as umbo. So this is umbo and this is perforatorium. So you will begin with that, means you need to study your perforatorium area of the specimens which you please hand over in the tray. You see, each one has its own characteristics, because the way it encounters, see, this is smooth perforatorium, but in some it may be sharp also. Here you can see that this is the top part, which is a perforatorium. So here it is blunt. In some of these it is blunt. In some of these it is, you can see that there is a small smoothly rolling type of structure on top with black color, which is melanin. So what you do is, I will dictate to you exactly the procedure. Now you have to describe these specimens. These we consider as Termitomyces hymi specimens. Okay, so first and foremost, if you look at this immature stage, this is the style, and it has been cut because there is another specimen which pseudoris are intact. Pseudoris are intact, yes, fine. So we can see that this is the perforatorium, a small notch is there. This is the pileus. Now the scales, you see, they come from a protective membrane like structure known as universal veil. Like, you know, people take veil, some sort of, you know, piece of cloth when they go for prayers and all. Muslims have veil. So same way mushrooms also have a veil. It is a part of their developmental, you know, process. Now that veil protects the immature reproductive organs, which are the gills here. So you see that there is a, you know, there is a fibrous tissue, okay, which forms a ring. This is known as membranous ring. So this fibrous tissue is part of the universal veil. Universal veil means a covering of highly differentiated thin tissue which protects the maturing pileus. This thing is pileus. This is known as sporocarp, basidiocarp, fruit body. So fruit body description, carpophore description, basidiocarp description includes mostly the reproductive part, and this has only a supporting role. This has no part in reproduction because it is purely a nutrient translocating organ like the trunk of the tree. What trunk of the tree is to a tree, and flowers and, you know, the fruits and seeds to a tree, this is the, you can consider this what flowers and fruits and seeds. The seeds form within ovaries. The ovaries form within flowers, and the flowers form on the branch, and the branches are supported by the trunk of the tree. In the same way, this is the style which supports the reproductive structure called a pileus. Below the pileus are the maturing lamella, gills. Gills are subdivided into lamella. They may be of same type. They are of different types, then we call them lamellulae. Shorter lamella are known as lamellulae. Then these lamella, lamellulae all have a supportive tissue called hymenophoral trauma. So basically I am describing Termitomyces hymenophore and Termitomyces hymenium. So Termitomyces hymenium means gills of Termitomyces. Now gills of Termitomyces are lamellae, and these lamellae may have smaller lamellae interspersed between larger lamellae called lamellulae. Okay, so the color is important, the shape is important, and what is important is how these gills are attached to the style. Because if gills are attached directly, they are concentric, I mean they are adnexed, we call it. And if they are not attached to the top of the style, they are known as free. So if gills are free, you will be able to see yourself later. Then, you know, it is easy to diagnose some of the species of this family. So Termitomyces shows a distinct collarium, collarium. Collarium is like an annular ring-like zone which separates the apex of the, or the tip of the style from the base of the attachment of the lamella or lamellulae. Means the all entire gene is separated by the collarium. So collarium is a no man's land like. Means neither it is true style tissue nor it is pileal tissue. It is a transient zone between style and lamella. It may have purely mechanical function. The detail, the role is not fully understood what the collarium does. But taxonomists know only this much, that collarium means a zone of separation from individual lamellae, from style. Why is it so? It's a big question mark which people will have to explore in diagnosis of Termitomyces species in future. What now has to be seen is, this is the full thing you can see here both. This is a beautiful example. A small fruit body I am having here. And here you see, I can give a full description of this fruit body. Now, this is a semi-mature or immature stage. We call it an egg stage or button stage depending on its shape. Okay, this pileus shape is of diagnostic importance, and there are at least 8 to 12 different shapes. Now at this stage I call it globose because it is hemispherical. It is like half of a sphere. So that is why it is called globose or hemispherical. Now at maturity it will become convex and later plano convex, as you can see from the one of these specimens, one of the one of the specimens here. So this is the immature egg stage and this is the mature, fully grown, developed, expanded, final stage, ready to discharge the basidiospores. You know, this is mature stage. Its entire genetic, developmental, evolutionary program is over. This is going to become this within 48 hours. So that is the beauty, that the fungus grows so fast after it reaches this stage, that within 24 to 48 hours this part expands and becomes this and then discharges the basidiospores. So if you see the underside of this, it is highly symmetrical. It's like a typical beautiful Japanese umbrella with a very nice. I will come to this part of diagnosis of the mature fruit body, because students of ecology, biology and taxonomy of Turbidomyces need to understand that for diagnosis, correct taxonomic diagnosis, scientists, taxonomists use only mature healthy specimens like this. So at least 5 specimens we have to examine for their features, okay, for getting a correct taxonomic diagnosis which one can publish. So today you are going to do the same thing by actually studying the diagnosis. Now we have 3 stages here. This is immature stage, which is different than this, and these 3 stages, you can see the difference between these 3 is a few days. So this will become this within 2 days and this will become fully mature mushroom within 1 to 2 days. So actually from emergence of the small primordium, epigeal primordia, to this, the entire life cycle we can say is around 10 to 12 days in Turbidomyces. So let us see now, because in these 2 mushrooms, Pseudorhiza, now let me describe this organ, which is purely underground, purely hypogeal, meaning its entire growth comes from below the ground. Now that word ground becomes extremely important in ecological sense and also in biological sense, because if the ground is impenetrable, mushrooms cannot develop because they cannot come out. If the ground is rocky, ground is hard, ground is solid, then there is no way that this perforatorium can become a stipe, and the stipe will bear the reproductive tissue. So there are limits imposed by the nature of the topsoil, nature of the roof of the mound underground, and nature of the composition of the soil and its moisture content, and also the environmental factors such as the intensity and the duration of the rainfall and the way the moisture is absorbed by the topsoil. If the soil becomes moist, it is easy for the perforatorium to stop its growth as a perforatorium and stop its growth as a Pseudorhiza and differentiate into a very interesting hypogeal organ known as the stipe. Now this is unique only in this species. In the world of mushroom, among 10,000 species that have been recorded, only Turbidomyces species display this transition from an underground hypogeal dark state, a hollow pseudorhizal state, to a solid epigeal stipe state. This is hollow, pipe-like, tube-like, flexible, you can fold it, you can twist it, rubbery. Now all this is a very important natural biomechanical property. It can be depressed, it's just like a plastic tube. Now this is nature's wonderful creation. The Pseudorhiza is hollow because you know that it has more mechanical integrity as compared to solid cylinders. Hollow cylinders, you know, they can work more efficiently in piercing hard substances. Okay, so what happens is the hollow part here has become the perforatorium here. Because it was drilling, then while drilling, it reached here. And then this tissue has grown further, differentiated. So basically pseudorrhiza is nothing but an organ which failed to become a stipe. And in dermatomyosis, stipe is something which refused to become a pseudorrhiza. That is the best way I can describe it. So in terms of histology, also there would be difference in compaction of the IPA. Whereas pseudorrhiza will show you capacity to produce a huge amount of exopolysaccharide, because that is what is required. And you can see also a black coloration here. Okay, there is a patch of black here, which we call as the all black pigments in the biosphere are melanin pigments. There is no other chemical in the entire biosphere, in all living species, including humans, mammals, animals, plants, birds. The black color is eumelanin or true melanin. It could be animal melanin, melanin in human hair, skin, or melanin in plants. It is black. So natural black color is imparted by very, very unique pigment called melanin. So here, while reaching the top of the roof of the mound, it encountered some pebble or some piece of rock or a hard object. So the pseudorrhiza didn't give up. The contact or abrasion with the hard object triggered a response, and it immediately produced at that spot a tougher material called melanin. So that protected the pseudorrhiza from further damage, because melanin is very hard. It's not soluble in acids and alkali. It is resistant to microbial attack. It is resistant to desiccation. It is resistant to radiation. And because of its so many properties, melanin becomes a protective type of pigment in fungi and mushrooms. So after crossing that particular obstacle in its path, this pseudorrhiza emerged on the ground, and immediately it stops its pseudorrhiza function, and something miraculous happened when this tissue sensed, the perforatorium which came out sensed that it has come out in open ground, in air, in an atmosphere full of oxygen, where rains are directly falling over it, and then it encountered light. So suddenly something which was growing in the dark for days together, this is one of the very important diagnostic aspect of disease. This is called a basal disc. There is very poor knowledge of the basal disc, although Roger Hine in his book has given a huge amount of importance to the basal disc. The reason is, he says that is the way the mushroom develops from its underground stage, by producing what is known as a basal disc. Now that basal disc is a sort of a small concave organ. These are the immature stages as they grow, and these are the immature pseudorrhiza. They have not yet encountered the roof. Okay, so the roof has to be pierced and the pseudorrhiza has to transit into a solid stipe. So you can see these are differentiated from those mycotites or spirules or nodules. So nodules make this after differentiation. So this is the overall picture that they have drawn. how the mushrooms emerge from mounds. You can see it. Okay, the full picture is given here. This is the basil disc, you can see it. And here you can examine it yourself, this part, basil disc, circulate. Okay, so what I expect you to do is to make a cross section of the basal disc and see. Now a little fungus comb material is attached to it. So you have to put it under stereo microscope. Remove that fungus comb material and arrive at the basal disc tissue and make a horizontal cross section. Understood? You have to mount it in plain lactopinol and congorate. Congorate mounts are always made in glycerol, drop of glycerol. Congorate stain mount, you have to make the mounting in glycerol and do not seal any slide. So your first job is to understand right from the initiation of the primordia, that is the basal comb. Also, do not discard that part of the fungus comb which shows white growth. That may be the basal mycelia which has differentiated from the fungus spirule or nodule, which I showed you. What it means is, it collapses, these whitish cottony balls collapse when it rains outside. Now how this happens is a mystery. What is the mechanism which causes collapse of this in some mounds, whether it is not possible to see mushrooms or other mounds, is still a mystery. Local people say that these are some of these places where every year they see mushroom, and there are some places where they say every 2 years or 3 years they see the mushrooms. So there are many complex epigenetic and epigenomic factors where genes respond to some environmental signals. So which signal molecules is a big mystery. Understood? How suddenly, you know, this particular, the growth which is seen here, responds to outside changes, climatic, meteorological, and then all these slowly disappear and you get initiation of pseudorrhiza, and pseudorrhiza 6, light, air, oxygen, and grows towards it, and rainfall perhaps. So basically what is happening is, you see very important vectors. What are vectors? Vectors are those which are extremely important in physiology of plants, fungi, and microorganisms. Because all the motion or movement or behavior, dynamic behavior, is in response to signals. For example, you have gravitropism, means growth of roots towards center of earth or gravity. You have hydrotropism. Hydrotropism is based on a vector which directs certain gene products in the plants to make the roots always grow towards a gradient of moisture. That is called hydrotropism. Then phygmotropism is what makes plant tendrils seek support. It can be any support. It could be a metal, it could be wood, it could be a branch, it could be a plastic rod. But you see that you can train that tendril. If the tendril recognizes at its point of contact or even from a distance that there is a support somewhere close by, and the tendril will wind itself in a such a manner that it makes the climber stand on its own weight and give further boost to the growth. So what is it that makes the growing, differentiating plant tendril to reach a support, seek a support, stick to it, roll it around, and then grow? So there is a vector called thigmotropic vector, gravitropic vector, hydrotropic vector, same way phototropic vector, phyllotaxis, the arrangement of leaves on a tree or a branch towards sun, towards optimal sunlight, toward optimization of sunlight, is a physiological response. But there is a light vector or a photonic vector, because of that genes in the plants work in such a fashion that the gene products make the phyllosphere, the entire leaf bearing photosynthetic part of the plant, grow towards sun and not away. So there is no gravitropic protein assembly in the plants, in the leaves. It is in the roots. So roots are exactly opposite. Roots do not like photons. Roots do not like light. Although they can tolerate, but that's not their behavior. So you have one set of vectors underground, another set of vectors overground. Now what is true and what has been understood from plant world, we have to apply to Turbidomyces, because it shows being a mutualistic exosymbiont, some unique behavior which is akin to plants. Pseudorhiza is known as Pseudorhiza because it's a false root. Pseudo false, rhiza roots. So what is happening in that case? Plants appear on Earth around 428 million years ago. All the genes in the plants were present much before that in eukaryotes, including yeast. But this mushroom is being cultivated by the termites for 150 to 180 million years ago. Before that, we don't know what was its common ancestor of that family life, Phylacea. They are still digging into it. But on the phylogenetic tree, you can see some of the clusters clearly show you it could be a monophyletic, species. So in that case, it is very interesting that it has developed in association with its gardener, its maintaining species, that is termites, a unique phenological, spectrum, that is the Pseudorhiza. So the Pseudorhiza, now most important thing is how the Pseudorhiza underground knows which way is the light, which way is the rain, and which way is the oxygen and air. Now that is not known. So the Pseudorhiza has to seek its contact with the roof first, and then there are certain signals which come out from external environment which interact with its cells, which we don't know how they interact. And then Pseudorhiza, once it touches, knows now I have to come out. For what I have to come out? To complete a evolutionary program, a morphogenetic routine, which is written in the genome of the Turbidomyces species. Like any other fungal species, it has to complete its pre-committed genetic program, that is to grow further, develop further, differentiate further, and disperse the spores. The Pseudorhiza exists only to perform that job. Once this is accomplished, the genetic program, its genetic commitment is over. Its perpetuation in the nature, in the habitat, in that ecosystem, in that biome, and in the entire biosphere for years to come is guaranteed once it completes this particular program. So the immature stages which you are going to handle, they are not supposed to be clonal, they are not supposed to be identical. If they are, there is something definitely wrong with the entire genetic program, which may be producing exactly identical clones, which is not possible because it has an underground stage, which is a hypogeal stage, and an overground stage, which is an epigeal stage. When you consider both the stages together, all the specimens which you have with you, you have to analyze, you have to diagnose, just to identify what are the differences in terms of it's the bulbous, the immature pileus, the universal wave. You write down this, see the features of universal wave, whether it is rolled up, whether it is entire, whether it is lacerated, whether it is broken into pieces.